It's a little bit.
Right before I come in on the last verse, what's the count for that?
Literally, it's
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1.
Bang. Yeah.
Okay.
Just like the choruses. We're going to do a sound check for the last song.
Oh, but okay.
We're not going to go through it. Hey, we ready? This is gonna suck. Yep. There it goes. All my life, all I know, God's been good, good to my soul. Mountain high, valley low, I'm gonna sing wherever I go. Sing all my life, all I know, God's been good, good to my soul. Mountain high, valley low, I'm gonna sing wherever I go.
I'm gonna see. when giants come calling my name. My God is so much bigger than troubles I face. Why would I hunger for power, riches, or fame? Oh, 'cause my God is so much better than all of these things. So I won't be
welcome to First Christian Church. I'm glad you all enjoying this cold weather. I hope you all have a bulletin. In the bulletin, there's some things in there. Our communion is in front of you. You guys can prepare that. Open it up. Get ready for communion. We'll have that in a few minutes. If you shake it, it'll taste a little bit better. Our offering is in the back. If you'd like to give your offering, please put it in the back. And today we will have Team Kids at 5 p.m. and we'll start here in the sanctuary. I hope you guys can come. We'll have an adult Bible study. We have the kids. And today's adult Bible study for the adults is, did God create the devil? You know, some wives may think God created the devil and the husband, but that's besides the point. But we want to thank those at Team Kids, those that have donated and donated the snacks. Also, out here in the foyer, there's a fill a baby bottle for Birthright. Please take one of the baby bottles home. As you get changed, fill it in, then bring it back to the church. And the money will be used for Birthright and helping the people with pregnancy. There was a video that I really wanted to show, and it was a ultrasound of a baby dancing. And I thought it was just amazing how, you know, how people can say, and I love the comments, is it's amazing what a blob can do. And so we don't have that, but keep that in mind. Now, elders meeting and executive meeting is moved until Wednesday the 16th. It's still at 6 p.m. The elders and 7 p.m. for the executive. We're just doing it on a Wednesday. And I think they did that on purpose because that's my day off, so they just figured just mess me up. So I think it's a payback for something, whatever. Take the wives to dinner. Oh, yeah. Oh, that's it. Yeah. So you take your wives to dinner on Valentine, which would be on Monday. So please look at your bulletin. Now, in your bulletin, there's the Roman road. So we're going to be talking a little bit about the message today. And that center part there has to do with the message. So keep that in mind. Keep everything. And we appreciate the food pantry for the veterans. We're still collecting food. We're taking it down as we fill up. Nancy Cook normally does that. We are going to partner with the United Methodist. They're going to give a food pantry to the veterans, same thing. So we're trying to coordinate between the two churches to, in other words, make one trip to Marion and take it down there. So we're working on that. Yesterday we had the men's No Regret Seminary or retreat, whatever you want to call it. It was really good. And I think men should attend those things. I think it's really, it had some great speakers. And they had some good music, and even one that Jim liked that just never wanted to quit. So Jim Clary said he's just one of those that keep repeating itself. And Jim was sitting down there squirming, going, oh, come on. But it was really good. I mean, the speakers were excellent. And matter of fact, Jim even mentioned, because we can now get it online, and we got them recorded. Maybe a couple of them will show up for instead of a sermon, because some of these messages were really important, especially the men. But it applies to all of us. It applies to the women as well as men. So we're going to try to keep that going. If you get a chance, go to these things. Women retreats, we need to set one up for the women. Men retreats, youth retreats, these things charge you up and you really see a different perspective of what's going on in the world. But yesterday it was put on by Bunker Hill United Methodist. It was very good. They served breakfast. They served, I don't say breakfast, but they had enough donuts there to feed an army. But anyway, it was very good. Those that attended, I thought it was very, I think it was something that we need to reach out to more people, more churches to come together and do things like that. So please look at your bulletin, look on the out there in the cafe area if there's any information going on. There is a seminar for financial seminar going on at Calvary Temple. We'll put that information out. That's coming up later in February. So there's things that we can do. And I will tell you what's nice about going to these other churches and participating is you get to know and start to know people from other churches. You know, not that you're going to attend that church. It's not the point. The point is we get to know people and we start fellowshipping as a family of God in the kingdom of God. So that way we can work together to reach those that cannot be reached just by ourselves. With all that said, let's bow our heads and pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you, we praise you, we worship you. You are an awesome and mighty God. Lord, come and touch our hearts, touch those that are hearing, touch those that are listening online, Lord. Lord, we ask you that you would use this church, Lord, to reach those that need to know about Jesus Christ. We thank you and we praise you in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning. Sunday of the month. Let's sing happy birthday to the people for January and February. Good job. Happy birthday. Let's stand and worship.
I am free. free. Oh, I am free. You picked me up, you turned me around, you placed my feet on solid ground. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, because you healed my heart, you changed my name. Forever free, I'm not the same. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, I thank God.
You turned me around, you placed my feet on solid.
Because you healed my heart, you changed my name. Forever free, I'm not the same. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, I thank God.
Song we can ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
Jesus, your name above every other. Jesus, the only one who could ever sing. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Jesus, the name above every other. Jesus, the only one who could ever sing. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Oh, holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken,
and I will build my life. Put my trust in you alone. Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Morning. Yeah, communion meditation, I got it from Acts chapter 9, starting on verse 10. In Damascus, there was a disciple named Ananias. The Lord called to him in a vision, "Ananias." "Yes, Lord," he answered. The Lord told him, "Go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hands on him to restore his sight." That was when Paul had his Damascus Road experience. Paul went to wipe out all the Christians here in Damascus and just purge that area of Christianity, and went there to arrest them. And he was almost there. He just about got to Damascus when he got struck down. And I can just imagine how his conversation was going on his way. He's probably talking about what's he going to do next. He's probably even thinking ahead or whatever he may be doing. We'll find out when we see him in heaven. But anyway, we all know the story, what happened. He got struck down, and he was just about in the city itself. And so the Lord appeared to Ananias. But here Ananias started to argue with the Lord. He said, "Lord," Ananias answered, "I have heard many reports about this man and all the harm he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And he has come here with authority from the chief priest to arrest all who call on your name." But the Lord said to Ananias, "Go. This man is my chosen instrument to carry my name before the Gentiles and their kings and before the people of Israel. I'll show him how much he must suffer for my name." Then Ananias went to the house and entered it. So Ananias did go. He had a very similar to what Moses. Moses didn't want to go either. Moses tried to argue with God. And we hear what happened here with Ananias as well. What would happen if Ananias said no to his vision? But Ananias did say yes, and the rest is history. As a matter of fact, the rest is God's word that's living and active, much more than history. But Ananias, because Ananias obeyed God. And also similar, there's a lot of experiences here. Where would these people be if it wasn't for someone else just before him? Thinking about the four men in Mark chapter 2, and not four, they just said some men, but there was a paralytic. Because of the crowd, they let him down through the roof. And Jesus saw their faith and said, "Your sins are forgiven," and healed. So he got his sins forgiven and healed. But where would that paralytic be if those four, if not four men? I keep thinking four, probably because one had each corner, but it says some men. And so they lowered him down through the roof. So where would the paralytic be if it wasn't for these four men? And often we all have testimonies as well. We would wonder, throughout my life, there's probably more than a handful, there's quite a few people that I can remember, look back and say, where would I be without these people? These people, I mean, my life is about ready to crash and burn. If you get in a situation where if you don't get outside help, you're done with. And I was in a few times, and people have helped me, and I'd say, where would I be without them? We all got a testimony, and especially when we first got saved, we had people praying for us before we got saved, and then we had people who witnessed to us. And I always remember the time when I was found in a parking lot, Rhein-Main Air Base in Germany, 1985, late May, a guy named Bob Kieker, and I always remember that guy because I always remember that name, never forget him. But he approached me in a parking lot and asked me a few questions. And one of them was, if you were to die tonight, where would you go? And I said, I don't know. He said, would you like to know? And really, above all things, I really wanted to know that because I was losing sleep over that for about a year. I said, yeah, I'd love to know. And to make a long story short, he invited me to a revival meeting. And the guy preached and made an altar call, and I immediately responded and then got connected with his Navigator Bible Study group. And so, but we all have a testimony, and our testimony will indeed preach. And so, we have a, you know, there's one pastor I know in Kokomo. He says, I've heard him say, I can remember faces, but I can't remember names too good. But he said, but there's one name I'll never forget. And so, yeah, it's the name of Jesus, the name above all names. And so where would we be without certain people in our lives? But above all, where would we be if Jesus did not come to save us? And that's why we gather together always in remembrance of what God has done for us. Now, on the night that Jesus was betrayed, Jesus gave thanks. Jesus took the bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Now, Heavenly Father, we come before you indeed with hearts of thanksgiving. Where would we be without you, Lord Jesus? Where would we be if you never came down here and rescued us from ourselves, saved us from our sins, and washed us, set us free, and because of him that we are in Christ Jesus. And so we thank you, and we're forever grateful for what you have done for us. And something that we'll never forget and remember for all eternity, and giving you praise and thanksgiving with an attitude of gratitude in our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. So we have several people here to pray for. What pops in my mind immediately was in James 5:16, says to pray for each other. It tells us to pray for each other. And the very next sentence says, the prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. And I wrote down mighty weapons. A prayer is really a mighty weapon that's at our disposal. And prayer can be a battlefield. Times we gather together, or time, especially in my quiet time in prayer, and we get tempted to say, well, nobody's listening, and you don't feel anything, and one of the worst things to do is be deceived by how we feel. How we feel has nothing to do with his presence. There's times where I'd pray in my quiet time and prayer time. I say, God, I'm waiting on you, because I didn't feel his presence. And God would speak to my heart and says, I'm right here, I'm waiting on you. So we never want to, you know, as God says that in his heart a man plans his course, but the Lord is the one who determines our steps. And here, we have several prayer requests here. The prayer, Kelly Brittle, she has surgery, I believe knee surgery on Monday. Remember her in prayer. Patrick, I know Patrick well, good friend of mine, great guy. He's having open heart surgery on Tuesday. And so keep Patrick in prayer as well. Our church family, FCC church family, we always want to keep each other in prayer, build each other up. This time, so we don't know who can be smiling, be having a great day, and yet they're about ready to lose it. But if we uphold them, we uphold each other in prayer, we become a rock solid and be guarded and protected. We have the God's covering in our lives. Pray for the family of Gladys Sheets as well. And so, Heavenly Father, we come before you with these prayer requests. The word says not to be anxious about anything, but everything by prayer and petition, we present our requests to you. We lift these prayer requests up before you. We lift up Kelly Biddle before you. And we pray for a successful surgery, for a knee surgery that she's going to have on Monday, and pray that rapid post-surgery recovery as well, that their physical therapy be successful and she be made whole in the end. For Patrick as well, Patrick have an open heart surgery. We pray that your presence be in the operating room, that you go ahead of Patrick, and that Patrick has that Patrick's filled with your peace, and that you guide the hands of the surgeons as they prepare to go through the surgery, and that open heart surgery be successful, and you have a successful recovery, and that Patrick be made whole and be all systems go in no time flat. We lift up our FCC church family for each and every single one of us, Lord God, that you meet us where we're at. We're all in different place, but yet we're all growing in you and being changed day by day. That you strengthen us and strengthen our family, strengthen us in finances, strengthen us in healing, strengthen us in relationships, whatever it may be. That you grant us the desire of our hearts as we delight ourselves in you. And we lift up the offering before you. As the word says that God loves a cheerful giver. And we thank you, Lord God, for each of us, for all of us who are able to give in the offering. We just give it all to you. And we give it all to you with hearts of thanksgiving. We ask you to bless the offerings and multiply it over as you did the fishes and loaves. We give this all before you with hearts of thanksgiving. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Children ages 4 through 4th grade, you can go downstairs if you'd like. Today, I'd like to talk about soteriology. Now, I'm going to talk about the doctrine of salvation, not the theology of salvation. Anybody know the difference? For example, how do you actually pronounce that word? If you look on your bulletin, I want you to tell me how you actually pronounce soteriology or soteriology. How do you actually pronounce that? Come on, we got some English majors in here. Now, can I ask you a question? See, that's theology. Does it matter? What matters is the doctrine. Sometimes we get wrapped around theology and we lose what the meaning actually is. Now, we have somebody accept Jesus Christ. He's sitting in the pew and an altar call goes out. He accepts Christ and he walks down the aisle and he does his prayer and the pastor prays over him. And he leaves and he gets baptized. When was he saved? When he decided that he would accept Christ. That's theology. Or it was when he walked down the aisle, when he actually broke the chains. Or it was when the pastor prayed. Or it was, I can do all these ors, it's theology. But what's the doctrine? Did he accept Jesus Christ? You know, everybody, can you kind of understand the difference? We can disagree in theology, and I was talking to Jim this morning, and I said, you know, I think churches are separated because of theology. We don't work with the Methodists or the Baptists or the Presbyterians because of theology, not because of the doctrine of who we are. We all believe that God created the world. We all believe that He spoke the world into existence. Now, God spoke the world into existence, did he speak it as somebody from Michigan or maybe a Georgian? Maybe he had a Georgian accent. You know, and let there be light. Does it matter? That's theology. What matters, the doctrine is, he spoke the world into existence. But we're divided by theology in different churches. We don't want to work with other churches because of theology. So today I want to talk about the necessity of salvation, soteriology, which means the doctrine of salvation, not the theology of salvation. There's a big difference between the two of them. Christology now is a study that covers the life, the death, the resurrection, and the exaltation of who Christ was. That's Christology. And many times you look at Christology also studying who Christ was before the cross. And what does that mean? That means every time there's a possibility and a study of where Christ was. For example, I believe when Abraham came and gave his tithes to the king of Salem, which is the high priest of the Most High God, which was a man named Melchizedek that had no genealogy. Anybody know what no genealogy means? You ain't had a papa and a mama. And I believe that's Christ. That was Christ because we are now, what? Priest by order of who? Melchizedek. So now, where is all of that? That's Christology. And I think it's an important study. But today we're going to cover soteriology about salvation. It covers Christ's death, his resurrection, and the accomplishment of what Christ did for mankind. So now we're talking not before the cross, we're talking after the cross. Now, I can go back to my example. When did that person get saved? When he heard the word, when he walked down the aisle, when he accepted, when he got, I don't know. I honestly don't know. I just know that for him to get into heaven, he has to know what? He has to have Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. That I do know. Now, we can argue and we can have different churches based on theology. You know, there's churches that are church. the group that we belong to, believe that if you're not baptized, you're not saved. That's theology. Do I agree with that? I don't know. All I know is you call upon the name of the Lord and you might be saved. You will be saved. And so therefore, independent Christian churches, for example, I had a Methodist pastor preach from this pulpit a few years ago. Because a Methodist pastor spoke from this church, from this pulpit, there's churches, independent Christian churches, those pastors will not even talk to me any longer. That's theology, dividing up the body of Christ. So today, the topic I want to talk about is faith, repentance, justification, regeneration, adoptions. All of this is covered under the doctrine of salvation. Have you been justified? Have you been regenerated? Are you a new person? What are these questions? Are you now adopted into the family of God? How many have heard of these words or these questions? That is the doctrine that we need to understand. I have two adopted sisters. My parents adopted them when they were little. Now, when did they become part of our family? When the court ruled it? Or when my parents saw these two little girls and wanted them part of the family? Sometimes we get in our theology about salvation, we get legalistic. Well, they're not your sisters until they are adopted. Well, they're not your sisters until 7 years after the adoption. Well, they're not your sisters. Come on. The moment that my parents decided that they were going to adopt these two little girls, they immediately became part of the family, and they immediately what? We're family. We're part of it. We need to understand that. So let's talk about salvation a minute. Let's talk about the necessity of salvation. And to do that, we've got to go back to Adam. Adam's sin brought death to the human race. Any disagreement there? Well, did Adam die when he ate of that fruit? Yes, he did. The Bible talks about two deaths. One is the physical death, which mankind was not suffering on. A lot of theology believe that man was not subject to death until after Adam ate of the fruit. Now, there's theology that'll back that. The doctrine says very clearly that the Bible, God said, if you eat of that fruit, of that forbidden fruit, you will surely die. The answer is yes, he did. But he died in a spiritual sense, and I believe, I'm telling you the reason I say I believe, because now I'm throwing in a little bit of theology, I believe death started with mankind at that time. Now, is that really important? To salvation, is it really important when death started, when men started to die? No, we just know that because of sin, the relationship with God was broken. Now, I can give you all the theology about it. I can tell you the Bible tells us there's two deaths. One is a separation from God. The other one's a physical death. And I believe when Adam ate of that fruit, he broke the relationship with God. So therefore, he had a spiritual death. And I believe that death entered mankind at that moment. But that's theology. What's important is he violated God. He rebelled against God. And, you know, I've said this before and I use it, the fall of man. I don't believe that's a very good theological word. It's not a doctrinal word. Man did not fall. Man rebelled. There's a difference between falling and rebelling. Anybody have any idea what the differences are? How many of you guys fall on purpose? right? You get out there, you see that ice, say, oh, yeah, man, I'm going to. No. You fall by accident. But I will tell you, you rebel on purpose. You rebel because you want to do something your way. And you've decided to go against what God has for you. That's rebellion. That's what happened in the garden. I do believe that physically, maybe, possibly, all I know is, you know, I got this philosophy that I don't celebrate birthdays. Why? Because in my philosophy is if you celebrate birthdays, you're admitting you're getting older. If you don't celebrate birthdays, you never get older, so therefore you stay young. So my last time I did a birthday, it was 10 years ago, so, you know, I'm 54 years old and I'm going to stay there. That's theology. The doctrine of the truth is, boy, you're getting old. But, so, as a result of sin, mankind spiritually died, and we know eventually every man is going to what? Is going to die, unless Christ comes before you die. But Christ's death on the cross provided a solution, both physical and spiritual. In application of death, regeneration abolishes the spiritual death, while the resurrection abolishes the physical death. Adam's sins corrupted the entire universe, everything in the universe, in the cosmos. In John 3:16, the translation is actually, for God so loved the cosmos that he gave. What's the difference between cosmos and for God and world? Most people think of the world as what? Earth. But God saved the entire cosmos. That's the reason I was telling somebody the other day who was talking to me about aliens. And I says, well, that's good. If we ever find some aliens in Alpha Centauri, I want to be the first missionary to bring the gospel, because God, Jesus, died for the cosmos, for the universe. Adam's sin corrupted the entire universe. As a result, the Lord eventually will destroy the heavens, the atmosphere, the earth, everything, and to purge it from sin, from the entire everything. People talk about, he says, well, it's going to be a new heaven and a new earth. And most people talk about it's going to be a remaking of the earth. Well, anybody know the size of the New Jerusalem? 1,500 miles square. That's 1,500 miles this way, 1,500 miles this way, 1,500 miles this way, and 1,500 miles this way. Anybody know how big that is? How wide is the United States? About 3,000 miles. So figure the city, half the size of the United States going across. Anybody know how high satellites orbit the Earth? 750 miles. So we'd have satellites hitting the side of the building. Now, in this world, could that city, what would happen if you put that city on this globe? Have you ever had a ball and you had a little thing on the side, how it wobbles? It wouldn't work. So you have to have a new earth, completely redone, for it to fit, if you believe the word of God. So he will create a new heaven and a new earth for all eternity. 2 Peter 2:20. For if, after they have escaped the pollution of the world, through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Listen to what it says. For if after they have escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, they are again entangled in them and overcome, the latter end is worse than the beginning. So if they've been pulled out, and I've said this many times to many people, If God and you're praying for healing, and healing comes, and God heals you, and you go back to living the way you did before, that sickness will come seven times harder on you. Bible says once you clean the heart and you put everything in order and you cast out all the demon, and if you go back and you open it up, the demons will come what? Seven times more into your heart. I have seen people be healed and go and live their own life, and within 6 months, they're back in the hospital, and the disease has come back. Revelation 21:1, and I saw a new heaven and a new earth. Understand, now I'm going to go to a little theology so you can understand. When God says new, anybody know what that means? Well, if you bought a new truck, a 2022, brand new truck, in the Bible, would it call it new? No. New means never before. Like the new covenant had never done before. It's something different. The new heaven and the new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. So what are we going to have in heaven? Something different. Adam sinned, brought necessity for redemption. Scarcely had Adam sinned than God had revealed his plan for redemption. We read that in Genesis 3:15. And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed, and it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Well, we know what that was. At the cross, it bruised his heel, but Christ crushed Satan's head. God provided a plan for salvation. The plan of God was to provide a redeemer for mankind. For God himself had to be that redeemer. Only Christ could redeem what man had done. Man had to find Jesus Christ. Doctrine is you cannot be redeemed by any other sense. Coming to church every Sunday will not redeem you. Only thing that will redeem you is the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, when you accepted Christ, you were covered by the blood of Christ, right? I may agree with that. Did the blood hit the forehead? Or did it hit the heart? Or did it hit the feet? Does it matter? Are you covered by the blood? That's all that matters. Now, as Christians, if you're covered by the blood, when you walk, you must step out with your left foot. Otherwise, you're not a Christian. Now, the stepping out by your left foot, does that have anything to do with my salvation? No. At least it doesn't to me. I'm right-handed, so normally I step out with what foot? The right foot. Until I learned in the Army that every time you start marching with the left foot. That's why they always get it wrong. But understand the difference between the theology that you people throw in and doctrine. By simple faith in Jesus Christ, God's Son, an individual is able to become a child of God. John 1:12, very simple. The message has been taken around the world and has transformed the lives of millions of people. And though millions of people worship Jesus Christ, they're always worshiping differently because of theology. And that's okay. You can have your theology as long as you don't allow your theology to break you away from the doctrine of the truth of Jesus Christ. For example, stepping off with your left foot. I could say, to be saved, I can believe that. I can believe that with all my heart. And therefore, God told me, Jim, to show that you're saved, every time you step off, you're going to step off with your left foot. What should Jim Loft do? Step off my left foot. But he's talking to me, not you. Now, he may have a reason why he has that to me. So, Jim, because you're just hard-headed, and I'm just going to make it difficult for you because you just don't think right. So, therefore, this is what I'm putting on you. I don't know. But what I'm trying to say is you can have your theology, you can believe in your theology, and you can follow your theology. The mistake we make with theology is we try to force it on people. What we need to explain to people is the doctrine of salvation, the doctrine of who God is. So, if you look in your bulletin in the center page, you got the Roman road. This is a simple thing that people have been using for years. Romans 3:23, we all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We're all sinners. We've all come short. We must receive eternal life as a free gift, Romans 6:23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. So, we're all sinners. We need to receive the eternal life. How do we do that? Jesus Christ paid the price. God demonstrated his love for us and his enemies. But God commendeth his love towards us in that we were yet sinners. Christ died for us. You don't have to straighten out first. You don't have to be better than somebody else. All you have to do is accept Jesus Christ. We must trust and surrender to Jesus as Lord and Savior. This is the key. If thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thy heart, two things, confessing and believing in your heart, God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For when the heart of man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confesses, is makes unto salvation. Very simple. So we need a salvation. We need to hear. We need to believe. We need to repent. We need to confess. And then we need to be obedient. And we need to be obedient because why? If we accept Jesus Christ, and I had a young lady years ago come to us and accepted Christ as Lord and Savior. She says, I'll accept Christ, but only if I don't have to change. I says, you can, but you ain't changed your destination. You can come down the aisle, accept Jesus Christ, and not obey God, not obey nothing, and not do nothing, and says, you know what? I got to figure it out. All I got to do is what Romans says, call out upon the Lord. Whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. I call his name out, and you know what? I'm going to live as a heathen the rest of the week. It says what? Believe in your heart. If a person does that, they're confessing with their mouth, but they're not believing in their heart. The full biblical salvation has full meanings. The word salvation has a rich range of meanings. It simply means health, actually, in the Greek. It means health. It is occasionally used to rescue from danger. Have you ever heard of that? Somebody saved somebody. Salvation, right? At the meeting yesterday, a guy gave his testimony. And I thought it was interesting was, he's sitting there, he took his family to Hawaii, and he was up on the hill, and there's a bunch of condos going down towards the beach. He was up on high ground, and down below, there was the little pool of water, the ocean, and where waves were coming in. When the tide was out, you could just, snorkel and just look around. But when the tide came in, it got high. Well, he's standing up there at his apartment. He looks down. And the tide comes in, dragging this lady out, and she can't swim. So he jumps and runs and goes, jumps these fences and goes down, finally gets down there, dives in the water, swims up there, brings her out of the water, lays her, put her down, gave her mouth to mouth, got her breathing again, and her children were crying. What did he do? He saved her. And what's interesting about his story was, and he looked up to where he had come from, and he noticed a whole bunch of people standing there watching. And many times, Christians are just like that. They think they're saved. They're standing up there looking down and saying, well, that's somebody else's job. If you obey God, your job is to take the gospel of Jesus Christ to the world. He physically left his place of comfort and went and saved her. Now, what did Christ do for us? Did he not do the same thing? And what's strange is that people are asking, says, how would you do that and risk so much to save someone you don't even know her name? This is what we do when we take the gospel of Jesus Christ and evangelism to people that we don't even know. We're reaching people on the internet that are coming to the Lord and accepting Jesus Christ that we will never know until we get to heaven. If you're being saved from drowning. But now in the Bible uses the word quite divergent. It's used in our spiritual relationship to God and its scope is as here it covers. Our salvation covers our past, our present, and our future. In the past, we are saved from the penalty of sin. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. For the wages of sin is what? Is death. So in the past, everything that we've done in the past is what? Is buried. Is covered. It's gone. Christ took all of our sins upon him when he died on Calvary. As a result, Christians stand today without condemnation. There is no condemnation found in those who are in Christ. There is therefore now no condemnation. 2 Timothy 1:2, but it is now made manifest by the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who hath abolished death and hath brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. So it is manifested, an appearance with Jesus Christ showed up. So through the gospels, we know that we have conquered death and we are now washed and cleansed by the power of Christ. In the present, now, that was the past. In the present, we are being saved by the power of sin. We're being saved from that power of sin. In the past, we were covered. All of our past is gone. In the present, the salvation, the gospel, is what? Saving us from the power of sin that we're living in today. How many of you have ever sinned after you've accepted Christ? So it's a process. We are being saved. We've been saved in the past by everything that we've done. We're being saved in the process of sanctification, which being the moment we receive Christ, saved, ends when Christ returns and we meet him. This whole process will finally end and we will, our bodies will be completely saved once we get to heaven. As long as you're on earth, I don't care how good of a Christian you try to be, will you still sin? Why? Because we still got the human nature on us. That has not gone away. You still have the sin nature in you. That came from the seed of Adam. That has not gone away. And every person alive today has come from the seed of Adam. How many would disagree with that? We did not come from monkeys. Well, maybe some of you, I don't know, but I didn't. The moment we receive Christ, He is restoring us as we walk. As Christians, we must constantly yield our lives to Christ so that sin will not reign in our bodies. As Christians, we constantly, Paul says, I pray daily that I get filled with the Holy Spirit. I pray daily. How many times have we prayed? How many times have you prayed? I prayed many times. Lord, forgive me for my sins. Lord, forgive me for sins A, B, C, and D that I have committed. Lord, forgive me for the sins that I've forgotten I even committed. Lord, forgive me for the sins that I committed that I don't even know I committed. He says, well, how can that be? Trust me, I offend people on Sunday mornings that I don't even know I offended. This important concept will help us to understand the value and occasionally the confusions of certain scriptures. Understand that we are in a process. We have not made perfect yet. If you think you have, there's counseling. Philippians 1:19, for I know that this shall turn to my salvation through your prayers and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ. So I know that this is going to happen through what? Prayers. Through coming and communicating with God. To confessing your sins with Christ. Now, I'm telling you, you need to confess this with Christ. You know, at Manor Church, Michael Fletcher was preaching and talking about, you know, if you have hidden sin, you should confess your sins. Well, that week, a gentleman walked into his office and says, I got a problem. He goes, what's that? He goes, well, you preached that I'm supposed to confess my sins. Well, that night, I went, and he was in the Army. He says, I was in Halo school, and I kind of cheated on my wife. And Michael goes, what do you mean? How do you kind of cheat? And he goes, well, I cheated. And I said, so what are you talking about? He says, well, after your sermon, I went and told my wife that I cheated on her. And she wants a divorce. And you said that divorce is, God hates divorce. And Michael said, goes, well, why don't you both of you come in and let's talk about it. It did work out, but sometimes, you know, use some wisdom in your confession. I have a friend of mine that was in, a guy that came to Christ when I owned a jewelry store in the flea market, and he showed up at my business one day and says, I need to pray for me. I go, why? He goes, well, I'm doing drugs again. No, he's not. I said, nah. He goes, no, I'm not. I'm going to jail, though. For what? He says, well, I was reading the Bible. It says, confess my sins. So I went to the police station and confessed all my sins. Murder, robbery, drug dealing, all the stuff that I had done. And they arrested me, and they're going to sentence me on Monday. So I need you to pray for me. What can you do for me? I gave him a case of Bible. It says, start a prison ministry. I don't know what to tell you, man. Well, anyway, about 3 months later, he came into the store, and I go, what are you doing? He says, the judge couldn't believe what I just did, that I confessed these sins. And he said, time served, you're set free. And it dawned on me, he had more courage as a Christian than I did. I would not go to a police officer that says, hey, Matt, stop. Give me a ticket. I was just speeding. But that's what he did. You see, that is the release that he had understanding his confession. Philippians 2:12, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. And this is what is important you to understand about your salvation. It's your salvation. It's between you and God. It's between you and Jesus Christ. It's not between you and me. The doctrine is, do you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Theology would be, you need to come to Bible study. You need to study this. You need to go through this. Forget theology. The doctrine is very clear. You work out your salvation. You decide what you're going to do with what Christ is telling you. 1 Corinthians 15:12, page 1767. First Corinthians 15:2. Moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel which I preached to you, which you also received, and which you stand. That's the doctrine of the gospel. By which you also, you are saved. If you hold fast that which I have preached to you, unless you believe in vain. Don't get doctrine and theology as one as a whole. How are you saved? By accepting Jesus Christ where? In your heart. You're not saved when the elders decide that you've reached a certain plateau, now you're okay. Some churches, you have to go do your confessionals to be saved. Work out your own salvation. This is between you and your God through Jesus Christ. We need to understand that very clearly. Don't put your calling on other people. We have a bad tendency of doing that. Why aren't more people singing? Well, I don't like to sing. Well, God has me singing, so you should be singing. You're not a very good Christian because you don't sing. Don't put what God has put in your life on other people. You have to work out your own salvation just like everybody else does. By which you are saved, you must hold on, hold fast to what was preached to you from the Word of God, unless you believe for no reason. 2 Timothy 3:15, and that from a child thou hast known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. How? From a child thou knew known the Holy Scriptures, the Word of God, is what determines if you're saved or not. Not by what a preacher says, not by what an evangelist says, not by what somebody else says. It is what the Word of God says. Who's going to answer to God at the great white throne? You are. Trust me, I got my own problems. I don't need to deal with yours up there. That's between you and God. I got my own issues that I'm going to have to deal with. Philippians 1:6, being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. So he's performing something in you until the day that Christ shows up. So it's a process. In the future, we will be saved from the present sin. Someday in the future, the Christian will experience the final, complete salvation. One day, the final step is going to be necessary because our flesh did not get saved when we accepted Jesus Christ. A lot of people will argue me with that. They say, yeah, I did. I said, no, you didn't. If your flesh was saved, why are you still sinning? That example, when that guy jumped down there and pulled her out of the water, and saved her from the water. She's on land. Is she still drowning? She's breathing. She's up. She's up. She's with her kids. Is she still drowning? Not in that water. Because she was taken out of that situation. Until we get taken out of this world, we're going to be sinning. We're going to be dealing with our sins. This final step is necessary because flesh did not get saved, but it will one day. Well, we will have a new body. We'll have a spiritual body. We'll gain a new nature, We will no longer be under the sin nature. We'll be under the grace, under God, in a perfect place. One day our flesh will be saved. One day we will have a body that's made perfect. Romans 8:22, for we know that the whole creation groans and labors with birth pains together until now. Not only that, but we also who have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, eagerly waiting for the adoption and the redemptions of our bodies. So first you're going to get saved spiritually. Eventually your whole body is going to be saved. And we're not going to have to deal with the sin nature again. We're not going to have to deal with these temptations again. We need to put on Christ. Romans 13:11, and do this knowing the time that now is the high time to awake out of sleep, for now our salvation is nearer when we first believed. What is Paul saying here in Romans? Now's the time, but our salvation is nearer, our body salvation is nearer than it was when we first believed. As you get older, I'm going to give you some bad news. As you get older, you're getting closer to the grave. How many of you understand that? So as we get older, from the moment we're saved, every day we're getting closer to that day when Christ is going to call us by name. Every day we're getting closer. That trumpet may sound. So Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation, the second coming. So, now I'm going to talk to those that are not saved. I'm going to mainly talk to those that are hearing. And if there's anybody in this room that does not know for sure that if you died right now, will you go to heaven? The Bible says you can have that assurance if you believe in your heart. But I'm going to talk about those that put off salvation. A sinner, he mocks the earnest scriptural appeal to be saved, especially now. Some other time. Some other day. Isaiah 55:6, seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. Isaiah is saying that you need to call on the Lord while he may be found, because there's going to be a day that you're not going to be able to. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. Today, if we hear his voice, harden not your heart, Hebrews 4:7. The sinner misses out on life that he could have because he refuses to accept Jesus Christ. He has allowed the world to block and hide. That many churches, many Christians today are so entangled in the world that they forget that we're not supposed to be of the world. We're living in the world, but we can't bring the world into our church, into our lives. But the sinner misses out on a life he could have. John 10:10, I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. I don't care what anybody says. Talk to people. If you sit in some of these counselings, alcoholics, drug addicts, are they happy? Look at TV. How many movie actors do you read that are really happy in their sin and their debauchery and everything that they're doing? The sinner misses out on a life that could be more abundant. The sinner, here's the thing. The third thing, the sinner encourages God's judgment. Amos 4:11, 12. I overthrew some of you as God overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah, and you were like a firebrand plucked from the burning, yet you have not returned to me, says the Lord. I overthrew some of you. I've done everything, but yet you still refuse to come. The sinner treasures up God's wrath against him. Romans 2:5. But in accordance with your hardness of your impenitent heart, You are treasuring up for yourself wrath in the day of wrath and the revelations of the righteous judgment of God. So you're building up this wrath coming to you. But here's the good news. There's always, right now is the time that you can accept Jesus Christ and not put any more of the wrath of God on you or your family. All you have to do is tell the Lord, say, Lord, I need you. The fullness that God is going to give you, the comfort that he gives. The sinner increases a gulf between himself and God. John 3:20, for everyone practicing evil hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his deeds should be exposed. How many times have we hide our sins? How many of us have hidden sins? All of it's going to be exposed one day. Wouldn't it be better to get on your knees and say, Lord, forgive me? The sinner has no assurance for tomorrow, James 4:14. Whereas you do not know what will happen tomorrow, for what is your life? If it is a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away? The sinner has no guarantee of another opportunity. This is the one that I want to focus on for a few minutes. Because a sinner, you do not have a guarantee that the Holy Spirit is going to come to you again. You have today. The Word and the God and the Holy Spirit is talking to you today. Luke 12:20. But God said unto him, thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. You don't know if you have time. Felix trembled and answered, go thy way for this time. When I have a convenient season, I will come to thee. And Felix found in Acts 24, it was too late. The sinner builds up resistance against the possibility of salvation. Proverbs 29:1, he who is often rebuked and hardens his neck will suddenly be destroyed, and that without remedy. The sinner increases his potential punishment. The Bible clearly teaches that there will be degrees of punishment in the lake of fire. Some people say sin is sin. Sin is not just sin. There are degrees of punishment. The indication seems to be that the more opportunities a person has to be saved, the more he will be held responsible for continuing rejection of Jesus Christ. I will repeat that. The indication shows the opportunities, more opportunities a person has to accept Christ and refuses it, the harder it will be. For unto whosoever much is given, to him much is required. Assuredly I say to you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah in the day of judgment than for that city. Matthew 11:12-21. Woe to you, Chorazin. Woe to you, Bethsaida. For if the might works which were done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago, sackcloth and ashes. Verse 22. But I say to you, it will be more tolerable for Tyre and Sodom than the day of judgment than it is for you. Most people talk and says, well, we have all the time in the world, but we don't. Reward her as she rewards you, and double unto her, double according to her works. Revelations. Therefore ye shall receive a greater damnation. Matthew 23:14. This verse reveals a very sober thought. The degree of punishment is often related to the opportunity one had received or how many times you have received the opportunity to be saved. Wouldn't it be a tragic if some of those who will suffer the most in the lake of fire were those that went to a good church or a good Christian school but constantly rejected the many opportunities for salvation? A person should be a fool to put off salvation. You are saved because of what Jesus Christ did on the cross. Are you willing to be obedient to the Word of God? That was another thing that was yesterday. He was talking about obedience. Being a disciple, being a Christian, is being obedient to His Word. I believe in God's Word. I believe what it says. I may not always understand what it says. I may not always interpret it correctly what it says, but I believe what it says. I don't know if that makes any sense. In other words, my human nature can twist things. My filters of my life can change or make me see things that maybe are not there, but all I know is to get to heaven, what I need is the man that went to the cross 2,000 years ago and died for Jim Loft. And by believing that he paid my prices for all of my sins, I have my name written in the book of life. And my name will not be blotted out because I will never reject my Lord and Savior. I will never reject who he is. I will never. I know he'll never leave me, so why should I leave him? How many of us have been up on those hilltops in your spiritual walk, and then you're in that valley where you feel God's a long ways away from you? If you're at the hilltop, is God with you? If you're in that valley, is God with you? Yes. And I think God's closer to you when you're in that valley, when you're suffering, and when you're needing him the most. Next week, we're going to talk about faith for salvation. What good is salvation if you have no faith? People says, well, I don't have faith. I don't believe in faith. Faith is something you don't see, but we do it all the time. How many ever flown in an airplane? You step on that airplane by faith. How many of you went and checked with the pilot to make sure that he knew how to fly the airplane? Well, Jim Clary, but every church has got one of those. But when you got that ticket and you're going to fly to your destination, how many of you got out your GPS and your map and made sure the plane was flying correct? No, that's faith. That's blind faith. Why is it so hard for Christians to have that blind faith in the Word of God? Next week, faith for salvation. Let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you, we praise you, we worship you. Lord, touch our hearts. Lord, touch the world. Lord, touch those that are maybe hearing this voice for the first time. Maybe they turned their computer on. Lord, maybe there's a message for them that today is the day of salvation, that they come and accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Lord, if many have accepted, if those that have, even if one have accepted, we know your scripture says, for the angels in heaven are celebrating because one has returned home. We thank you and we praise you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
All my life, all I know, God's been good, good to my soul. Mountain high, valley low, I'm gonna sing wherever I go. Sing all my life, all I know, God's been good, good to my soul. Mountain high, valley low, I'm gonna sing wherever I go. God is for me, he's not a All I know, God's been good, good to my soul. Mountain high, valley low, I'm gonna sing wherever I go.
Have a blessed week.